بینندگان عزیز سلام، امیدوارم تا این لحظه رو به خوبی و خوشی پشت سر گذاشته باشید و اوقاتی رو که امروز با هم هستیم اوقات بهتری داشته باشید. خوشحالم که پس از 10 سال باز فرصتی پیش آمد تا با آقای استیفن کینزر صحبت کنم. من ایشون رو سال 2002 یا 2003 وقتی که کتاب تمام مردان شاه رو نوشته بودن باشون مصاحبه کردم و پس از اون دیگه خبری نداشتم تا اینکه کتاب جدیدشون اومد. اجازه بدین که این مصاحبه رو با انگلیسی صحبت کنیم و اگر کسی نمیدونه که من فکر میکنم بیشتر ایرانی ها انگلیسی میدونن، بعدا ممکنه زیرنویس فارسی هم براش بذاریم. Mr. Kinzer, welcome, and it's very good seeing you again.
Great to be here. Thank you.
All right, thank you. 10 years ago, either 2002 or 2003.
Something like that.
Yeah, I remember. Anyway, I'm so happy to see you again, and the reason I call you and ask you to be my guest is your new book, The Brothers.
Yes, so my new book focuses in part on Iran, but in the larger sense, it's the biography of these two remarkable brothers who ran American foreign policy during the 1950s. So John Foster Dulles was the Secretary of State, and his younger brother Alan was Director of the CIA. It's the only time in history that brothers controlled the overt and the covert sides of American foreign policy.
Oh, that's...
So this was very dangerous because they came from a background where they saw the world the same way, they believed the same things, and...
I'm sorry, this one was during Kennedy era?
It was during Eisenhower.
Eisenhower.
So Eisenhower named both brothers to run his foreign policy. And because they had such a similar view of the world, they never consulted with anybody else when they set out on these foreign operations. It was just a kind of an echo chamber between the two brothers, and that allowed them to set in motion huge projects around the world that wound up shaking nations.
On your book, actually the title of your book is The Brothers, and it, you said John Foster Dulles and Alan Dulles, and their war?
Yeah, the subtitle is, the book is The Brothers, John Foster Dulles, Alan Dulles, and Their Secret World War. So what do I mean by that? I think that at least we Americans have misunderstood the 1950s. We think of that as a period of peace, tense peace. But actually this is not true. I now realize from all this research that I did on this new book that the Dulles brothers and Eisenhower were involved in a constant world war during the 1950s. We didn't see it because much of it was waged covertly and secretly, or when it came into public view, like in Indonesia or Guatemala, we were told by John Foster Dulles that we weren't involved, that it was just a local conflict. But now we can see that the Dulles brothers never stopped one covert war or clandestine operation without starting another one. This war was fought in many different places. The theater of operations changed. Iran, Guatemala, Vietnam, Indonesia, Egypt, Cuba, the Congo. But there was a constant effort by the Dulles brothers to undermine governments that we didn't like. And I think in many ways they misunderstood the world. In the 1950s, the Second World War was just over. Many countries were emerging from dictatorship or from colonialism. They were looking for a place in a turbulent new world. Many of these leaders did not want to participate in the Cold War. They didn't want to be in favor of Moscow. They didn't want to be in favor of Washington. They wanted to develop their own countries. Mossadegh in Iran was one. Arbenz in Guatemala was another one. Sukarno in Indonesia. Nehru in India. Nasser in Egypt. They were all neutralists. And Mossadegh called it positive equilibrium. Keep a distance from the two powers. But the Dulles brothers could not accept this. They insisted that every government be pro-American. And if you were trying to be neutral, in their eyes, this was a sin against the United States. In fact, in some ways, they saw neutralism as worse than Bolshevism. because it didn't obviously seem as bad as communism, but it was. So when the Dulles brothers looked at leaders like Mossadegh, they were not able to see a nationalist patriot. What they saw with all these leaders, Mossadegh, Arbenz, Sukarno, Nasser, Nehru, Lumumba, was a series of pawns for the Kremlin. They thought these people were all part of a plot from Moscow, and that the Soviet Union had concluded that certain countries were not ready for communism yet. We can't take over those countries yet. So what we will do is we will place at the leadership of those countries figures who are actually doing our work for us, but they won't say this. They will pretend that they're just anti-colonialist or they're just nationalist, and then when the time is ripe, they'll put their country under communism. This was a complete misunderstanding of the new third world nationalism that was such a big force in the 1950s. It made the United States into the enemy of many leaders and many countries and many peoples who didn't have to be our enemies.
When I saw George Bush and the way he was talking about other people in other country, either you are with us or you are against us, then I thought he's the only, I mean the first one started, but the way you're talking, these two brother was pro this, saying that either you are with us or you are against us and we have to do something for you.
Yeah? You are absolutely correct. You just have to change the last word. So the Dulles brothers' idea was either you're with us or you're with the communists.
Oh.
With Bush, it was either you're with us or you're with the terrorists. But it's the exact same idea. And I tell you one way that I think the Dulles brothers assimilated this idea. So they grew up in a very religious household. But it was a particular kind of religion. They were in the environment of missionary Calvinism. So the father was a Presbyterian clergyman, the grandfather, the great-grandfather, the uncles, the great-uncles. Many were clergymen, and not only clergymen, they were missionaries. They felt that the world was divided in a religious sense between good and evil. There's the good religion, which is Calvinist Protestant Christianity. Then there's all the religions that are bad and that are wrong. And a good person, that is a Christian, does not have the right just to sit home and hope that the good triumphs over evil. You must go out there and crush the evil. Now, if you believe that about religion, it's a very short step to believing the same thing about politics. You begin to think that there are good governments and good regimes and good leaders, then there's the evil ones. And the good people, that's the Americans, are not allowed to sit home and just hope that good triumphs. You must go out into the world and make it happen. So with this missionary attitude, they decided they had to transform the world. And I think this really did shape their worldview. Now, it's a very different view than the view that people in many other cultures grow up with. In many countries, people are taught everybody has some good and some evil in them. Every government, every institution, and these come out in different proportions according to different situations. The Dulles brothers did not believe this, and they saw people like Mossadegh, because they were not 100% pro-American, as enemies.
He should be communist or something.
Exactly. Or they thought that actually these people secretly were being manipulated by the communists.
Okay. When I was listening to you on Amy Goodman show, if you didn't mention the name of these two gentlemen and America, and didn't name the country that were could over there, I could not believe that you were talking about USA or America. My question is, if something like this happened in Iran government or another government, I said, okay, this is the way they are. But here, we have something, we the people. And for me, as somebody that came here, I can satisfy myself and say, still this is the best country, at least it's better than my country. How Americans react to this kind of, act, and why they didn't say anything or they didn't do anything. And Where was the rest of government? We are talking about, state, and CIA. You know, we have so many other branches and so many other powers that divided between, and they can enforce and talk and do something.
Well, first of all, President Eisenhower strongly supported what the Dulles brothers did. He liked the idea of covert action, and I think in his own mind, he thought of it as a kind of a peace project, because it meant that you wouldn't have to send armies into battle. You could overthrow governments without lots of people dying and major wars going on. One great mistake that the Dulles brothers made, and Eisenhower also made, was that they had no idea that their interventions and their covert wars and their secret coups would have huge effects years and decades and generations later. In the writing business, we sometimes have this line, every story is either happy or sad, depending on where you end it. Now, for the Dulles brothers, after they overthrew Mossadegh in 1953, they looked at the story and thought it was a great success. They had gotten rid of someone they didn't like, Mossadegh, and they had replaced him with someone, the Shah, who would do everything they wanted. So it seemed like the perfect outcome. Only now can we look back and see that these interventions have huge effects many years later. So I think this is something that none of them understood. Now, you asked about the reaction of Americans and why these episodes are so well known in the countries where they happened, but not so well known here. Well, in my books, I'm only trying to present history as it actually happened. In my books, and including this new book, The Brothers, the chapter that I'm the proudest of is the chapter with all the footnotes. Everything in this book is a fact. Everything has a footnote. Everything comes from somewhere. There's a source.
Documents are there.
It's all documented. I'm not making this up. This is not a polemic. This is simply laying out facts. Now, why are these facts so unfamiliar to Americans? I think not just the coup in Iran, but the coups in Guatemala and the wars that we fomented in places like Indonesia and our attacks against Castro and so many others are not well known in the United States because they don't show us, Americans, the way that we think we are. You know, when I first went to Iran, in 1997, to cover the election campaign that produced President Khatami, it was my first visit to Iran. I didn't know much about Iranian history, and one of the first things that struck me when I was in Iran is what a huge difference there was between where this country should be and where it is. When you look at the map and you see Iran is the big country right in the middle of the Middle East, and you understand the thousands of years of history back to Cyrus and Darius and Xerxes, and you think of the cultural impact that Iran has had, you think to yourself, why should a country like this not be a democracy, but be poor and unhappy and isolated? Well, I asked this to people when I was there, why didn't you develop a democracy? And they said to me, oh, we had a democracy until you came over here and took it away from us. Well, I was quite surprised to hear this. It doesn't fit in with my self-image or my self-image of my country. And so I resolved when I came out, as soon as I got home, to buy a book on what happened in 1953. Imagine my surprise to realize that there was no book about it. Nobody had written about it. So I realized that if I wanted to read that book, first I would have to write it. And that was the genesis of my book, All the Shah's Men. Now, I've also written books about other coups that the United States has staged in different parts of the world. And when I travel, and I'm now traveling around America, speaking about my new book, The Brothers, I tell you, there's one comment that I get from my American listeners all the time. It always comes up. They always say something like this, why didn't I know any of this? Or they say, I studied history. I thought I knew what happened in America, but I never knew this. Or, I went to college. I read a lot of books. This never turned up. So why? I get asked this a lot, and here's what I think is at least part of the answer. In the United States, we have a intense fascination with World War II. There is no end to the videos and the movies and the books about and the documentaries about World War II. Now, was World War II a very important moment? Of course. But I think there's another reason why we're so fascinated with World War II as Americans. World War II shows us the way we want to think that we are. We went into countries where they had terrible, brutal dictators. We got rid of them, and we left them with democracy. So we love hearing this story, because it makes us the good guys. Other stories don't make us look so good, and that's why we don't want to hear them. Now, the Dulles brothers are responsible for many of those stories that don't make us look good.
Ignorance?
You know, it is ignorance.
Or the ego, or what?
I think Americans are, in large measure, ignorant about the outside world. But I don't think that's the real problem. Many people in the world are ignorant. But I would say there's a difference with our ignorance. If people in Paraguay are ignorant about Iran, that's unfortunate, but it doesn't really have any effect on anything. But we Americans act on our ignorance. When we're ignorant, we use our ignorance as a basis for action, an action that sets countries into great upheaval. So that makes it worse. Now, here we are sitting in Washington, and as I was driving here to your studio, I drove by Dulles International Airport.
Yeah, actually, this is Washington Airport, located in Virginia.
Exactly.
And it was named after
John Foster Dulles. So here's the story. John Foster Dulles died in 1959.
By whom it was? By Kennedy.
I'm going to tell you the story.
Maybe that's why I connect these two. Okay, go ahead.
So as soon as Foster Dulles died, President Eisenhower announced that the new airport being built here in Chantilly, Virginia, would be named Dulles Airport. But soon after that, Eisenhower left office. Kennedy came into office. He didn't want to call the airport Dulles Airport because Dulles was a crusty symbol of the old Cold War. Kennedy wanted to project a newer image, but there was much resistance. The Dulles family and President Eisenhower pushed back, and finally Kennedy agreed to name it Dulles Airport. So when I was writing this book, The Brothers, I decided that I wanted to go to Dulles Airport and see the big bust, the statue of John Foster Dulles. I've seen the video of President Kennedy opening the airport. President Eisenhower, the former president, is there. Alan Dulles, the younger brother, former CIA director, was there. The widow of John Foster Dulles was there. So Kennedy made a little speech. And then he pulled back a curtain, and there is this big bust of John Foster Dulles. That's the center of Dulles Airport.
But isn't it lower level?
Well, I decided I want to go find it. So
yeah.
I hadn't seen it. I was like you. I thought, how did I miss it? So I arranged to go through Dulles Airport on a trip. And I asked the first security guard I saw, where's the Dulles statue? Never heard of it. I was very surprised. I said, well, who do you think the airport is named after? He said, I don't know. I guess someone named Dulles. I said, but where's the statue? Don't know. So I thought, I asked another guard. Also, he doesn't know. Nobody can find it. I had to get on my airplane. I never got to see it. So then I started making phone calls and sending emails. Where is the bust of John Foster Dulles? So with the help of somebody that works for the Washington Airport Authority, on my next trip to Washington, I was taken to see the bust. So this bust is not in public view. It is in a closed, curtained conference room.
They hide it away.
Opposite the baggage claim number 3. Oh, it's hidden away. No one can see it. So I asked myself, why is this? And I think part of the reason is that the Dulles approach to the world did not work out well for us. Iran is a great example. You cannot look at Iran and say, oh, good move by the Dulles brothers to get rid of Mossadegh. Nobody will say that. So I think we have a lot to learn from the Dulles brothers. And they have lessons to teach us that are relevant today. But we don't want to learn those lessons. That's too difficult. Instead of confronting what they did and thinking about it, we forget them. We just brush them out of history. And what happened to the bus, to me, is
under the rug, yeah?
Exactly. Put it in the conference room. So to me, what happened to that bus, that statue, is a good metaphor for what has happened to the Dulles brothers. These people were so famous in the 1950s, there probably was not a literate person in the world who didn't know the name Dulles. But now, they are almost totally forgotten. So my book is an attempt to strike back against this historical amnesia and bring the Dulles brothers back to life for good and also for bad.
Let me ask you this. When you write books like this, what is the reaction of American people? I know, based on your book, Iranian people have mixed reaction. We will talk about that. But I'd like to know about American people. Do they appreciate that you open this kind of subject, or they get against you and they say you are ruining our, you know, reputation? And
actually, I've had a very good reaction from Americans. I think people in the U.S. like to think that we're well informed, and when we figure out that this isn't true and we're learning something new, we're happy, we're interested. So my books are an attempt to bring untold stories to the American public, and I think the reaction is generally positive.
You know, in Iran, before Khomeini was Shah, and we have some people that still are pro-Shahs, and his actually son live here in Maryland, and they believe that you were commissioned or paid by mullahs to write this book. But when I ask you even about the Farsi version of that, if you want to talk about that, how was it start up for this book, All Shah's Men?
Actually, the genesis was my first visit to Iran in 1997, and I couldn't believe that this story had never been told. Now, when I was writing that book, All the Shah's Men, I remember thinking to myself, you might write a better book than this someday. You might write a book that will sell more copies than this someday. But you are never going to find a story that is this big in history that has never been told. So I wrote that book entirely on my own initiative, and I'm happy to have done it. But now in my new book, The Brothers, I also have a whole chapter on the Mossadegh coup of 1953, and I came up with a whole new set of information, material that has never been published before, that helps explain why they did it. Shall I explain this?
Sure.
So this is material that I find absolutely fascinating. We know that the Dulles brothers were outraged by the nationalization of oil in Iran, and we know that that oil company, the Anglo-Iranian oil company, was owned by the British, mostly by the British government. But in my research, I discovered that the Anglo-Iranian oil company had a financial agent.
This is after that book.
All right, this is what I'm finding out now
in
The Brothers.
In this book. This is stuff. The Brothers.
This is in my new book and has never been published anywhere. So, the Anglo-Iranian oil company had a bank, a financial agent, that ran all their finances. It was a big international bank called the Schroeder Bank. Now, the Schroeder Bank's lawyers were John Foster Dulles and Alan Dulles. And in fact, Alan Dulles was on the board of directors of the Schroeder Bank. So he had to go to the Schroeder Bank people and say, we failed you. You hired us to protect your interests in Iran, and you just lost them. So they never forgot that. When they were private lawyers, they couldn't do anything about it. But once they came into power, they immediately came after Mossadegh. They had a grudge against him from previously. But here's the bigger story, and this, I believe, really is something new. Many older Iranians might remember a little bit of this, but here is a fascinating story. In 1949, the big American engineering companies formed a big conglomerate with the idea of undertaking large-scale, huge-scale projects in other countries. They had this very American idea. We will take over poor and backward countries and we'll make them into California. We'll transform them totally. And they began to focus on Iran as a place where they would do this. This consortium of engineering firms was called Overseas Consultants, Inc., OCI. So OCI made a study of Iran. It's five volumes long. It's probably the most detailed study of Iran that's ever been made. You can find out which diseases the sheep had in the Kermanshah area, or how many pipes there were to bring water around Abadan, or every little detail about Iran. Very thick. I tried to buy a copy. It's $1,000 on the internet. But fortunately, there's a copy in the Harvard Library. I was able to go look at it. So, the OCI people were negotiating with the Shah, and they needed him to sign, to agree. This was $650 million in 1949 money, so a huge amount of money. It would have been the biggest overseas development project of all time. They were going to take over Iran, bring in new industries, reroute rivers, transform the economy, really a huge utopian plan. Now, the Shah, of course, was quite young. Mossadegh was also rising at that period. The National Front had emerged. So the Shah really wasn't sure whether he could or should sign this huge contract. So OCI had to hire someone to go to Iran and try to persuade the Shah to sign. So they hired Alan Dulles. Alan Dulles was then a lawyer with this famous Wall Street law firm, Sullivan and Cromwell, but he had also been chief of the Near East Division of the State Department. He knew the Middle East, he knew the Shah, so he was the perfect person. So as a private lawyer, he went to Iran in 1949 and he negotiated with the Shah. As a result of that negotiation, the Shah signed. This was the greatest triumph of Alan Dulles' legal career. And it was even reported in Time magazine. They said, it opens up a whole new area of the world for American business. And of course, for American strategic interests, you would have Americans all over Iran. So, great breakthrough.
It was a big success for Alan Dulles.
It was Alan Dulles' biggest success as a lawyer in his whole life. While Alan Dulles was in Iran in 1949, something was happening. The Shah was the subject of a protest because he had tried to rig an election, and the National Front organized a protest in which people came to the palace and they sat on the lawn for days and days, and they said, "We're not leaving until there's a new election." So, not only did Alan Dulles come to know the Shah and make a partner out of the Shah, but he saw what was the terrifying alternative. These populist demagogues who were insisting on terrible things like free elections. And who was the leader of those demagogues? Mohammad Mossadegh, the head of the National Front.
He was not young as Shah.
No.
He was not as scary.
So, Alan Dulles came away. I know who was our good guy in Iran, the Shah. And I know who's the bad guy. Yeah. This was 1949. So, Alan Dulles was so pleased that he invited the Shah to New York, and the Shah spoke at the Council on Foreign Relations. That was the inner circle of the American foreign policy elite in those days. And Alan Dulles and John Foster Dulles were founders, co-founders of the Council on Foreign Relations. So here arrives all the foreign policy elite of America, and Alan introduces them to the Shah. Essentially what he was saying is, this is our man in Iran. It was the moment when the American foreign policy establishment sealed its tie with the Shah. That was at that meeting in New York in 1949. But then what happened? The National Front decided they didn't like this contract, and it was debated in the Majlis. I actually hired an Iranian student to go through the Majlis records, and she has actually found some lines from the debate over the OCI contract. Members of the National Front were standing up and saying, this is not good for Iran. It's too much money, and these are foreigners. They don't understand our country. We should have our own people do this. And in the end, the contract was canceled. Alan Dulles' greatest success was crushed. And so I think Alan Dulles not only sealed his friendship with the Shah, but when the project crashed, he knew that it was Mossadegh and Mossadegh's National Front that were responsible for this. So between that and the fact that it was the bank that the Dulles brothers represented that lost its interests with the nationalization of oil, we see that the Dulles brothers developed a grudge against Mossadegh even before they came into office. So they came into office dedicated to overthrowing him. And a new biography of President Eisenhower has recently come out. And what it says is that Eisenhower did not come into office with any feelings about Mossadegh. But every afternoon after work, John Foster Dulles, the Secretary of State, would go to the White House and have drinks with President Eisenhower. And slowly over time, he persuaded Eisenhower to take over this project. Why were the Dulles brothers so focused on overthrowing Mossadegh? There may have been strategic reasons as well, but the fact of this huge contract being taken away from them, and the fact that the bank they represented had lost their interest with the oil nationalization, is, I think, a big part of the reason why they came into office gunning for Mossadegh, and they didn't even wait for Eisenhower to be inaugurated before they started meeting with the British and others who wanted to plot this overthrow.
Thank you very much. For sure, we should get the book, The Brothers, and Mr. Kinzer, you're going to be at the NAIAC book signing tonight?
My Iranian friends have invited me in a number of places. In a sense, I can tell them something that I don't tell my other friends, and that is that the Iran chapter in this book is especially interesting because it starts with exactly this episode about OCI that I don't believe anybody has ever written about. So for people interested in the Mossadegh coup, this book, The Brothers, will give you a new take on it, and it's full of some very interesting new details.
Very good. I will try to be over there, NAIAC members only. I mean, it's for members only. I'm just telling them, you know, in case. I already talked about it yesterday too, that they contact them and RSVP. And once again, all I can say, thank you for just, you know, your time and effort to write about Iran, write about all other countries, and those that they are against you, especially those that they are pro-Pahlavis, now they should see this was not your only book. You wrote 8 books, yeah, so
that's
far?
Right.
And one of them, not accidentally, but it was about Iran, but they are against you, as they are against Mr. Carter. Mr. Carter went to California for book signing, and can I call them some stupid people? Attacked him.
Well, I feel, you know, my books are only telling real history. You know, we used to have a police show on television when I was a kid. And the police officer used to tell crying women and angry victims, just the facts, ma'am, just the facts. That's all I'm telling. All I'm telling is what happened. What you think about it, what you want to do about it, that's your business.
I'm glad you said, I mean, all of them is, you know, based on document and the search and research that you did, and they are, as you said, for Iran Parliament or Majlis, you said we went through their paperwork, I mean, their record and everything.
Well, I hope my Iranian friends will take a look at this chapter because I think it sheds a new light on the coup, and also it gives you an idea of what Americans are reading about Iran, and I think in these days that's very important. So thank you.
Thank you very much. I wish you luck, and I hope to see you soon.
Inshallah.
Is your next book writing, or you are thinking about it, or not yet?
When a woman has just given birth to a baby and they're taking her out of
the
room,
never,
do you say, what's your next baby?
Okay,
please,
sorry,
give me a little more
question,
time.
Thanks
okay,
again.
Thanks again.
Best wishes. All right. خیلی ممنون دوستان عزیز. بعد از 10 سال, it was after 10 years, آقای استفن کینزر رو دیدم, but you look good, the same. I mean, you know, I should ask, what's your secret? Maybe your next book should about that.
Fesenjan.
Oh my God. He knows everything about Iran. He's very, I mean, interesting guy to talk to. And if people want to buy your book, Amazon
is the best place to get it. It's cheaper, it's easy, you can get it in 2 days, and I encourage especially Iranians to go out and look at it.
Okay, and if they want to talk with you, be in contact with you, you know,
I have
Facebook
a website, stephenkinzer.com,
okay.
And you can contact me through that website.
Okay. Thanks again. خیلی ممنون که با ما بودید. اگر سوالی پرسشی دارید با تلفن یا ایمیل و مستقیما با ایمیل با وبسایت خود آقای استیفن کینزر تماس بگیرید. همیشه جواب میده، خیلی آدم مرتبیه و اسم کتابشون هست The Brothers. حتما بگیرید و بخونید و در مورد صحبت میکنید. مرسی که با ما بودید.